coming here this evening. My name is Brian Summers. I'm a professor at CCSU, and part of the work that I've been doing since coming to CCSU, actually since getting tenured when I could do the work that I wanted to do, was doing work on the geography of wine. This is something coming from Northeast Ohio, which is not wine country by any stretch of imagination. It's something that I came to strictly by accident. I started out on this as my first job as a grad student at Miami University in Oxford, Ohio. My advisor, he was giving out the jobs for all new grad students, and being at the end of the alphabet, when he finally got to me, he said, well, you're going to be the teaching assistant for the geography of wine class. And I thought that was a joke. It actually was very interesting. Two sections of 90 students each. This was in 1987, when you could still drink on campus. And so half the class was lecture, half the class was tasting wine every night. And as a grad assistant, my terribly onerous job was to open the bottles, make sure the frat guys didn't steal them, and to deal with anything that was left over at the end. So I was very popular amongst the other grad students. But when I came here, years of being a sort of serious academic, I was actually approached by one of our book reps. Do you have any ideas for a book? And I started talking about this because I found that using wine examples in an introduction to geography classroom with 18-year-olds didn't fly very well. And she said, oh, that's a great idea. And so hence the book. I will never write another one because of the wonderful experience that this was. But since then, what I've been doing on rare occasions, I'm mostly a teacher these days, is teaching related courses. Every once in a while, I get a chance to teach the geography of wine as a full semester course, and I'll be doing that again in spring of 19. And when I put the book together, it was with the notion that this would be a really cool thing to do for sort of adult tours. And of course, the book comes out at the height of the oil prices in 2006, 2007, and that has never happened. But since then, I've just had fun in settings like this, sort of talking about the topic and sort of introducing people to why wine and why geography? Because I assume that none of you are geographers, being that this is the United States, none of you probably ever took a geography class. So how you fit those two pieces of material together is probably just a mystery. Hopefully we'll solve that mystery tonight in the context of talking about South American wine. And when Danielle and I were going back and forth via email on potential topics, she mentioned the possibility of doing something on South America. And for me, that was very intriguing because I had done a lot of research for the book, and I've been planning the sort of South American getaway, going up and down Route 5 in Chile and visiting winery after winery after winery. And so this was a good opportunity to sort of rekindle that interest. But what we'll be getting at tonight, and what I get at for 16 weeks in a regular course, is that great wine doesn't happen by accident. It is good geography. And it's also a heck of a lot more interesting than talking about the geography of corn and wheat and less interesting stuff like that. But when I was doing my intro to geography class, each one of these are sort of weekly topics in an intro to geography class. Every single one of them I could address with wine. And so my book is sort of Geography 110, all about wine. And it's really an interesting topic in that when you talk about how wine is made, winemaking is basically a pretty standardized process. There's a way to make red wine, there's a way to make white wine. The interesting thing is that even though the process is pretty standardized, what you get in different places can be wildly different. And that difference from place to place is the kind of stuff that sort of gets geographers interested in the subject. And the process of alcohol production, it's a chemical process. And you're just turning sugars into alcohol through fermentation. Not terribly geographic. And in some cases, even the facilities that produce the alcohol, you look at that and say, that could be just about anywhere. But what we see around the world is that what people use as inputs has a lot to do with where they are and what their culture is like and what their environment is like. And what you produce as your output is also linked to specific places. So that even if you're looking at the same varietal of wine, like tonight we'll be looking at three varietals that come from someplace else but are produced in South America today. But they'll be different on different sides of the ocean. Different cultures producing that wine. And what it gets down to, and before I go further, if you have questions, feel free to just sort of shoot your hand up or just ask away. You won't be bothering me. It sort of goes with the territory. What we'll be talking a lot about is the fact that wine is a product of environments and people. And that's what really sort of makes it so very different when you go from place to place. Because what the environment does, soil, climate, weather, landforms, that just sort of sets the boundaries. And what people do is they use their culture, their economics, their history, to sort of work within those boundaries to say, what can we make, what can we do, what can we produce, what can we profit by in this location? And with respect to wine, wine very much reflects both the people and the environments. That's why, particularly when you look at French wine, they use the term terroir, talking about the connection between environments and people. You really can't connect them because the product is the people are the product. And you see that when I was an undergrad, I did a summer program in France, and this was back when I was just a beer drinker. Working in a little town called Flaubert in the French Alps. Mostly we just drank generic beer because we were poor college students, but the locals, the people that we were working for, would always bring us their local wines because it wasn't just that they wanted to get us drunk, it was that they wanted us to experience what their place was all about. And to them, that product, the vin de Savoie, was key to understanding who they were as a people. And so they were ecstatic when we would drink anything they put in front of us and say, oh, this is really good, because it was confirmation of who they were and that their product really appealed to us. And the reality is that when we buy wine, we're really buying images of people and the land. And to sort of follow up on that, have four photographs here. Which of them looks most appealing to you? Bottom right?
Yeah.
Okay. Ignoring the fact that it says Chateau Margaux there. This looks appealing. Maybe this sort of looks like the end of Indiana Jones. But it's still sort of appealing. These? Nope. But the reality is, if you drink wine, you're probably drinking much more of this kind of stuff than that. Because that's sort of the reality. We buy the image, we sort of ignore the reality. Likewise, these images, what speaks to you? Which one of the four speaks to you?
The village.
Okay, bottom left.
Top left.
Okay. Why does this one speak to you?
Hand picking.
Hand picking. A gentleman has probably been doing that his entire life.
Yes.
The experience, the knowledge. Here, you're not paying attention to a tractor.
Uh-uh.
You're looking at the Alsatian village. It's like, oh, this is how it should look. This, yeah, not too bad. You sort of ignore the fact that this is the valley of the most back-breaking labor possibly imagined. And then you look at this, mechanized, no. See, what you're really doing is buying an image that varies from place to place. And with vintners, they know you're buying that image. And so if you go to your local wine shop and you go looking for wines from Chile and Argentina, these are the kind of images that they are trying to sell. And they're trying to sell this image of the Andean vineyard. And if it's in Chile and you see the Andes, you know that it's looking east. If it's in Argentina and you see the Andes, you know that it's looking west. They're both trying to sell the exact same thing because they know that that appeals to you. Even though the reality is a lot of that wine is being produced in those steel vats that you saw two PowerPoint slides ago. But they know that that connection with place is important to you. And it's important to really all consumers. But the reality is that what you see is that image isn't necessarily what you buy. These images, in this crowd, if I said Bartles and James, you understand what that means. You remember Bartles and James wine coolers. This is the Gallo facility in Modesto, California. This is the Gallo facility in Livermore, California. And for a frame of reference, you probably can't see them from where you are, but you have semi-trucks. That is a frame of reference. And these are all of the different wines, very few of which include the words Gallo, that they provide, that they sell, that Gallo owns. And that's really sort of the way the wine market works these days. Big corporations buying up lots of vineyards. And when we go to the tasting at the end, you'll see the impact of that, even reaching into Chile and Argentina. We just prefer not to. When I brought out this slide for my wife, her favorite wine is Ecco Domani. She was really rather appalled at where it comes from. because we all are. We don't want to think that our wine comes from someplace that looks like an oil refinery. Now, taking this to South America, there are really sort of four intertwined stories that if you understand the stories, you understand a lot of what goes into and what went into South American wine. And the interesting thing is that those four stories, climate, rain shadow effect, colonization, and the French Connection, are also very much key to understanding California, Oregon, and Washington State wines. The reality is that these stories are very much the stories of the West Coast of North and South America. And if you understand how these things fit together, you really understand the whole story of South American wine. Now we'll start off with the one that we always start off with, and that's climate. Now, not to get into real heavy-duty science here, but just to understand that what the grapes that we use to produce wine are a very small portion of the family of grapes. It's Vitis vinifera, and as best as we can tell, it comes from this part of sort of the Middle East, southeastern Europe,
countries of Georgia and Armenia. That's where the Greek originally evolved. And it evolved under the climatic conditions that exist there. So if the Greek evolved under those conditions, if you have conditions that are similar to that, you can grow those grapes. Now, there are lots of other grapes that grew up in slightly, or evolved in slightly different kinds of environments. We just don't necessarily use those types of grapes in winemaking. There are all sorts of grapes that are native to North America, but most of them we maybe use as table grapes. We don't use them very often in making wine. We do occasionally, but not very often.
So, in terms of the climate, we're looking for places that are really similar. And I'm not going to belabor this, but we're talking about this little area here. It's a map of world climates. And it's where the green that is marking Mediterranean climates sort of runs into semi-arid climates. Mixing climate and viticulture, grape growing. It's sort of just a matter of sort of recognizing that if the climate's the same, the grapes will probably do okay there. And so if we look at places that have similar climates around the Mediterranean, little bits of South Africa, parts of South America, parts of Australia and New Zealand, you start to have a map of where wine comes from. Now, maps like this, I sort of enjoy this because it really, really overstates the case. Because you look at these areas, and what they're telling you is that these are places where you could produce grapes for winemaking. It doesn't necessarily mean that you do. And even in, this is a Wine Folly wine map for South America. There are places in this bright green and in the lighter red where you do have grapes being used to produce wine. There are lots of other places where it could be, but they just don't. And we'll talk about that in a second here. But for geographers like me, there's some key questions there. Because what we're doing is we're comparing where the grapes can grow versus where they will grow well. Those maps just show where they could grow. It doesn't mean that they'll grow really well there. And can they grow well and produce what you want? Grape production for winemaking is different than grape production for distilling. It's different than grape production for table grapes or raisins or grape juice. So it's really a matter of saying, okay, is this the perfect location for what we want to do? Make wine. Is it a place where we can do that on a regular basis? Grapevines take 3 or 4 years to really get into production. Some of them don't hit their stride for 20 or 30 years. You don't want to invest in that if it's only going to be good every other year or every third year. Sort of a waste of money and time and energy. And really, can you do that and make money? That's always a key question. And will that money exceed other things you can do with the property? And are there people there who know what to do with it? We were doing South African wine. South African wine is a wonderful story about people who have no idea how to make wine. South Africa, as a colony, first of the Dutch and then of the English. What do farmers from the Netherlands or England know about making wine? It wasn't until they started importing French Huguenots who knew what they were doing before that industry took off. And then there's a lot of equipment, a lot of material that you need to sort of put that industry into action. Do those things exist? But the most important question is, do you have the right climate? And this is called a climate graph for Yerevan, which is in Armenia. And what it's showing you here, very simply, these green bars are average monthly precipitation, rainfall or snowfall that's converted into liquid. Daylight, daytime temperatures. Notice the pattern here as you get into summertime. What happens to precipitation? It drops off to almost nothing. For comparison, a place that you're probably much more familiar with, Bradley Airport. You can still see the pattern of temperatures. They're also giving you the minimum and maximum temperatures. But essentially, it's still the same thing. Precipitation, daylight, temperature. And you notice July has a slight dip in moisture, but not a whole lot. It's nothing like Yerevan. And it's definitely nothing like San Francisco, where they do almost get nothing during the summertime in terms of rainfall. Or where we're going in tonight's material, Concepcion, which is on the coast of Chile. What you're seeing there is, with Mediterranean climates, the key thing is they dry out completely during the summertime. And this is tremendously important for growing grapes to produce wine. You can grow grapes around here. When I'm jogging around Weathersfield, there's all sorts of grapes that are growing naturally. But you don't necessarily use them to produce wine. Because what we're looking for is a few key things that make wine growing, grape growing for wine, possible. First of all, and to be honest, I don't know a lot of the biology here. You need to have a cool enough winter for the plants to go dormant. Temperatures below 50. That's a must. You don't know why, but the biologists tell me that this has to happen. You also need ideal conditions in the early growing season. Decent amount of rainfall, no big storms, especially when the plants are flowering. Because if the flowers get knocked off the vines, then you have wonderful vines and no grapes. Not an ideal outcome. And no late frosts. Late frosts are a real problem. And you need a long, dry growing season. And the nice thing about grapes is that if it's dry, that's okay. They'll root down 5, 10, 15, 20 feet. There are parts of the Bordeaux where you'll find grapes that are rooted down 25 or 30 feet. They'll go and they'll find the moisture down there. And probably the most important thing is you want good weather at harvest time. And that is to be as dry and warm for as long as conceivably possible. The last thing that a vendor wants is rainfall near harvest time, because that creates two problems. First of all, and you may see this with your, if you garden, if you do vegetables, you may see this with your own crops. Moisture brings molds and mildews that can destroy the crop. And moisture can also fill the grape or the apple or whatever you're growing with lots and lots of additional moisture. And that's not a good thing. You don't take a glass of wine and throw water into it. That would essentially be what would be happening if you had heavy rainfall near harvest time. The vintners, they want sugar in the grapes. Not a lot of water, but a lot of sugar. And rainfalls, early season, like around here, you're really fighting the weather, hoping that you get nice dry weather in August, September, and October. Now, there are places where you can do really good wine, like parts of Connecticut, even if your environment is not ideal. There are different kinds of Vitis vinifera grapes that do well in sort of various kinds of climates. And you can find isolated spots where just in that one location, the climate is just perfect, even though everything around it may be awful. If you've been to parts of the Moselle River Valley in Germany, there you have on one side of the hill perfect growing conditions and crappy growing conditions everywhere else. So if you take one of the river cruises, it's like, oh, look at all the grapes. And on this side, oh, look at the cows. Different climate just because of the physical conditions. You can also cheat. If you go, for instance, to the orchards at Glastonbury, you'll see that the big propellers for moving air around when there's a frost coming, that the pots that they'll light up to sort of try to generate enough heat to raise it 1 degree or two to prevent the frost. You can cheat, and in doing so, make it possible to grow grapes in places like Connecticut, where, yeah, in past decades, it really wouldn't have worked. And if you look at the wine varietals that we know, you start running down the list, and this is what I can think of, I sort of ran out of room here. All of these different kinds of grapes evolve in slightly different growing conditions. And so it's a matter of saying, okay, this is my plot of land, and the growing conditions are X. Which one of those will work in my location? Experimentation. And so you just sort of, again, match one to where you are. But then there are some situations where no matter how you try to finesse it or cheat, your weather conditions, your climate just is not suited to producing wine and growing grapes. As humans, we have a wonderful capacity to find different kinds of ways to produce mind-altering chemicals. And if the climate's different, then you produce beer. If you are in sugarcane country, you distill it to produce various offshoots of rum. You can take apples and make hard cider. There are places in Hawaii where they take pineapples and make pineapple wine. Not the greatest stuff in the world. But regardless of where you go, there are ways that people find to produce the things that they want. So they can sort of cheat climate or just sort of take their product in whatever direction the climate dictates. Now, in the case of California, Washington, Oregon, and Chile, Argentina, and Peru, there's a sort of an additional consideration here. And that's called the rain shadow effect. And it has to do with those very large mountains that are in all the photos that you see from the Chilean and Argentinian vineyards. Those mountains have a huge impact on weather conditions. And as an example, this isn't from Argentina or Chile, this is from Washington State. On the coast of Washington State, you have one of the wettest areas anywhere. Hundreds of inches of rainfall every year. You have what's called temperate rainforests. You go over the Olympic Mountains, you go over the Cascades, and you have semi-desert and wine production, grape production for wine. If you've been to California, you've probably seen stuff like this. On the coastline, you have very wet conditions, redwood forests. Two valleys over, you've got Napa. 10, 15 miles, 20 miles difference, completely different climates. And it's because of what's called the rain shadow effect. Now, I'm going to introduce some very, very basic science here, nothing to be scared by. But what we're looking at is how do we take really cold, wet air from off the Pacific and turn it into desert-like conditions where we can grow grapes for wine production. And it has to do with ocean currents, but it also has a lot to do with humidity.
Now, when you hear the folks on the news talking about humidity, they give you humidity as a percent. 90% humidity, 100% humidity, 50. They're telling you essentially how much moisture is in the air versus how much the air can hold. Sort of, it's a relative measure versus the absolute amount of moisture that's in the air. And the key thing here is that the temperature length there. In the mornings, it's really, really humid. You'll find dew on the grass because the colder the air, the less moisture it can hold. Humidity gets to 100%, and moisture condenses out and ends up on your lawn. As temperature rises during the day, humidity drops off. The warmer air can hold more moisture. Now, the key thing here is that when air moves, in this case over a mountain, it's going to change temperatures. If it's changing temperatures at less than 100% humidity, it's going to be changing about 10 degrees for every 1,000 meters. I know we don't use the centigrade here, we don't use the metric system, but the math is a lot easier, hence using it here. If the humidity is below 100%, it'll drop about 10 degrees for every 1,000 meters it goes up. But when it hits 100% humidity, water condenses, little bits of heat are released, and that decline in temperature slows. It's only 5 degrees per 1,000 meters. So if this is the coast of Chile, you've got the Peruvian current, which is ice cold, cold air pushing up over the Andes. It cools off. Now, as soon as it passes over the top, it starts to descend, starts to heat up. Humidity drops below 100%. Rainfall stops. And so what you end up with is one side of the mountain which gets all the precipitation, the Chilean side where you see all the snow. The other side where it's heating up becomes dry. And you might just see snow at the very top. You can sort of tell by the pictures if it's the Argentinian side or the Chilean side by how low the snow line is. But the big thing is you go from cool and wet here to warmer and drier here. And you can really see that on the coast of Chile. In California, it's why you have heavy rainfall just west of where you have Death Valley. But what it does is allows for a perfect condition to grow grapes for making wine in a place that we otherwise would just be awful for it. And so what you're seeing here is places that the rain shadow effects make possible grape production for wine. And it's not very obvious on this, but on this one, okay. May not look like much, but these hills here are sort of like the Coast Range in California. Enough rainfall here that this central valley ends up being dry. Route 5 from Santiago south bisects that valley. There's nothing but wineries on either side. And of course, by the time it gets over the mountains to Mendoza on the Argentinian side, it's desert, where they have to actually irrigate to produce grapes. That's all because of the rain shadow effect. If that effect didn't exist, you wouldn't have much in the way of wine production there. Now, culturally, wine production in this area has everything to do with colonization. A little bit of history that indicates why grape production ends up here. Now, this part of the world colonized by the Spanish. Their motivations, they want the resources. At the height of Spanish conquest, about 25% of Spain's budget was being produced by their colonies in the New World. Big money maker for them. There are political reasons for them to be here.
if they didn't colonize, then the Portuguese would, the French would, the English would, and who would end up losing out? The Spanish. So it's that sort of competition of politics. There's also some interesting social reasons. Some of the historians do really interesting work looking at Spain's history. In the 1400s, the 1300s, they're fighting to push the Moors out of the Spanish peninsula. Essentially a warrior class that sort of kept at relatively even levels because a lot of them don't survive that combat. 1492, the Moors are pushed out finally. And Spain is left with, hey, we have our territory now. But they're also left with a warrior class that no longer has anything to really do. Lots of younger brothers who they're not going to inherit, they're not going to marry well. They're probably just going to be there causing trouble. What do you do with them? You send them as far away as you possibly can. My brother and I don't get along very well. I sort of find this process of colonization via younger brothers is somehow appealing. But you also have to consider on the part of the colonizers, the conquistadors. They're looking at this as an opportunity. There's no opportunity at all. Their older brothers, or even if they don't, even if they are the older siblings, Spain is a crowded place, even at that time. So what are they going to do? How are they going to make their mark economically, politically, and then socially as well? How do I get my independence? How do I make my mark on the world? We make it in the new world. To some extent, these motivations coincide, but to some extent, they also don't. And that's where wine comes in. Now, if you talk about the history of wine in the Americas, really to talk about the history of wine anywhere, there's sort of this myth of wine monks, wine priests, that wine is being experimented with, produced by an intellectual priesthood that has the time and the intellectual capacity to do different kinds of grape cultivars, to experiment with it, to see what they can do. A lot of that history is true, but a lot of it's also overblown. Yeah, the conquistadors, the missionaries took grapevines with them, producing wine for sacramental purposes. There's not a whole lot of wine that's used in that respect. The wine trade also becomes a way that Spain tries to exert control over the colonies. You're sending all these warrior types across the ocean and having some idea that you're somehow going to control them. Good luck with that. 6 months away by boat. How do you control them? By having economic control over them, by having things that they can't get in the new world. So what the Spanish government tries to do is restrict trade in those things to allow them to control the colonies. Manufacture goods of different kinds, but basically wine and some other products. They also forbid wine being traded between the colonies. What they want is those people trading back and forth with Spain. Send us our share of the loot, but also pay us exorbitant amounts of money for shipping you stuff overseas. And this is sort of the point of conflict. And this is what really pushes wine production in the New World more than missionaries and sacramental uses of wine. Because remember, these folks, it's part of their diet. Alcoholic drinks in the 1400s, 1500s are probably safer than drinking water because of what could be carried in the water. It's part of their diet. And these folks are, they basically know when they cross the ocean, they're not going home. But they want the comforts of home, and food comforts are very high on that list, including wine. And so what happens is, as the conquistadors move through Latin America, they take viticulture with them. 1520s in Mexico, 1540s, they're not exactly sure when it reaches Chile, and 1557, it crosses the Andes into Argentina. Basically, what you're looking at are conquistadors, missionaries. All of these folks know where wine comes from at home, what conditions it grows under, it's produced under, how we do it. And so as they're marching through South America, oh, this is like my home, and we grow this there, and let's give it a shot here, and lo and behold, it works. And it allows them that freedom from the control of home. Now, this is where things get sort of weird, given that it is the Spanish-speaking world. I use the French connection here. My students don't understand what that means. They've never seen the movie. But it's sort of interesting that if you look at, take a look at the list there. Other than the one wine varietal that's underlined, what's common amongst all the other wine varieties that are listed?
They're French wine.
Every single one of them comes from France. You're talking the Spanish-speaking world, and the only major wine varietal on this list that comes from there, actually this one comes from Spain. There's another one that you'll be sampling later that's actually indigenous to Latin America. All of these wine varietals come from the French. And there's a few things that go into that. That's all part of the history wine and sort of the French influence. First of all, similar climates. The west coast of South America isn't all that different climatically from parts of the west coast of Europe. So you just, once again, match the climates, what grows well. And in terms of the French impact on the industry, the French, their long history in the industry, the investment of time and energy in studying how to produce wine and how to create new great cultivars, they have a huge impact on the industry no matter where you are. French wines sell. Back when you had sort of the beginning of the wine industry in the United States, they would call red wines Bordeaux or Burgundies because those words sold. It didn't matter if it was the most obnoxiously horrid backwoods red grape that you could find. They would call it a Bordeaux or a Burgundy because people would buy it. What you basically were doing was convincing people to buy just French wine. They were not going to be fooled by your use of French terms. But it's also part of French investment in the industry. Not just investment of money, but people and energy and knowledge. If you're in France, there's only so much land that you can produce grapes on. And that land is ridiculously expensive. So if you're going to college to learn about enology or learn about viticulture and you want to make money, it's tough in France. But if you go elsewhere, and find opportunities. You're the expert that people will hire on. But it's also because of one of the first examples of where human beings had really a horrendously disastrous impact on one of their own food products, the phylloxera louse. This is one of those cases where we inadvertently trash our own environment. And in some sense, it all comes from here. What ends up happening is, in the early 1800s, British botanists are trying to figure out how they can grow grapes for winemaking successfully in Britain. Because importing wine from countries that you're fighting, like Spain and France, isn't the easiest thing in the world or the cheapest thing in the world. So they're taking a look around here. What's growing in North America where the climate
is similar to Wales or the Black Heath region or wherever. And so we're taking back all of these cuttings to Europe. Well, what they inadvertently do is they introduce this sucker into the European biome. And what this bug does is it eats away at the root system of a grapevine, killing it off. And from the 1850s through the 1890s, by the 1890s, European wine production was only like 25% of what it was before phylloxera enters Europe. The whole industry was trash. Whole types of grapes become extinct in Europe because they just are even more tasty than the normal grapes to this sucker. And so what you find is people try different hybrids. This variety is less susceptible to it. Root graft. The interesting thing about grapevines is that you can graft rootstock and the upper vine together, even though they come from different plants. So they discovered that if you take American rootstock, which survives phylloxera quite nicely, and you put the European varietal on top of it, you're good. But that takes decades and decades to retrofit the industry. And if you're coming out in your 20s and 30s and want to make a mark in the industry, you can't wait decades. And so what ends up happening is a lot of European vintners start to look elsewhere. My home vineyards are trash. What do I do? Where do I go? How do I make a living? And so they go into South America. A lot of French, but also a lot of Italians, Spaniards, even a few Germans go into South America because that ocean buffer, phylloxera has never really gotten into Chile and only a little bit into Argentina. It's a safe haven, and they go there to try to find opportunities. Now, you'd think that this would be a great thing for South American wine. In the early 1900s, you're free of phylloxera. You can go out on the market and make a whole bunch of money selling wine to foreign markets. The problem is that you're way far away from those markets. Also, you tend to produce good season, you produce a lot of wine, not necessarily the best wine, very inconsistent. And what happens, especially when you get into the latter half of the 20th century, especially the 1970s and 80s, military dictatorships, guys like Augusto Pinochet, regulating the wine industry almost out of existence, such that they really aren't exporting anything. And we're also not necessarily buying wine from people like that. The Falkland Wars were disastrous for the Argentinian wine industry because prior to the Falkland Wars, their biggest export market was Britain. So not only did they lose the war, they lost the economy after the war. Hyperinflation, I don't know if you can see from where you are, but here's a million peso note from Argentina. Now, the nice thing is, and the nice thing for us, is that this has really turned around in the last 20, 25 years. First of all, we're seeing a decline in transportation costs, especially air transport, heavy air transport. Big 747, you lift off the front, these big bins are pushed in, and that wine is on its way. They've also done a heck of a lot, especially in Argentina and Chile, to improve quality and control yield such that people are willing to say, oh, this is worth trying. It's a lot easier to drink wine from governments that you can actually stomach. And they also had a wonderful advantage coming into the marketplace in that the prices of those wines were dirt cheap. They still aren't terribly expensive. It's a great kind of marketplace if you like $10 or $12 bottles of wine. You had a huge amount of outside investment
especially in the wake of his departure and in the democratization of Argentina, lots of outside investment. And more recently, their biggest export market now is the Chinese market. Turning a billion people into a potential market for wine has done wonders for the South American industry. Concepcion on the coast, big freighters just loading up and heading right across to Asia with their product. And so what you see as a result is that Chile is now the world's fourth largest exporter of wine in terms of dollar value. In 2016, they exported nearly $2 billion worth of wine. A lot of wine. Argentina is in the top 10. They were a paltry $817 million worth of exports. And for comparison, France is one at $9.1 billion. Italy is two. Yes, but this is a huge change from when you wouldn't have even found them in the top 20. And more importantly, what it means is that you can actually find these wines locally. Go back 15 years ago, we probably couldn't have done the South American wine tasting because you wouldn't have found it here. Now, even the most marginal wine stores will have Chilean and Argentinian products. Probably not Peruvian or Bolivian or Uruguayan or Brazilian because they don't export much. But Chile and Argentina are definitely on the radar screens here. And it doesn't hurt that their wines have won all sorts of international competitions, wine tastings, testings. It's done wonders for their marketplace.
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
What about Australia? I see a lot of Australian wines in the stores.
They're third. Thank you. Yeah, Australia is third, which is interesting considering how far away they are from the markets where they sell. But yeah, they can somehow get all that yellowtail wine into your homes. And if you ever want to see a winery that looks like an oil refinery, Casella Wines, the producers of yellowtail, it's impressive. But what this, once again, does is it gets the wines into stores around here, and it gets us to the most important part of the evening, which is the wine tasting.